New Bedford, Dayton, Detroit, Michigan. What's the institute?
The Temple of Ma'at-Tahuti.
Temple of Ma'at-Tahuti. That's Detroit, Michigan. What's the date?
July 13th.
Oh, wow, that's when I look at numbers.
See, now I said the slogan yesterday. I said June, so I wasn't going to rush out there.
Yes, so July the 13th, full moon, right in the heart of the summer solstice. Yeah. And we are back. And it was interesting here because that song came out in 77, fall 77, that album. But that year, the black music reached its peak as far as the talent. Because that year you had a lot of first time groups to come out that became powerhouse. Like the group Slave, Frankie Beverly and Maze came out, the first album, 77. Heat Wave, first album in 77. I believe Mother's Finest, first album, 77. No one had been able to duplicate the Supremes as far as in popularity of the three girl group. But in 77, the Emotions came out with that Rejoice album, produced by Maurice White, and it just blew the socks off everything. That same year, Barry White came out with the album with Playin' Your Game, Baby. It's a beige album cover, can't think of the name of that. But it was so much that came out that particular year as far as first-time groups came out that particular year, so it was a real powerful time. You had Summer Slam killing white folks up in New York. You had the Blackout in New York. You had one of the greatest albums ever to come out that year with Songs in the Key of Life with Stevie Wonder. So it was a lot going on at that particular time that encapsulated that whole, the peak of that era. And they came, and then Urban and Fire followed this, the fall of that same year. Sheep came out that year. Group Sheep was a bunch of people. Cameo came out that year for the first time. So you have a group of people that came out for the first time that particular year. Isaac Brothers did Voyage to Atlantis. Now Go For Your Guns, and it was just the Brothers Johnson followed up the second album with Strawberry Letter 23. There was just so much happening at that particular time, and when we say that the 70s was almost a vanguard era for black people, it was the last time that you could still be poor and still basically be in the thick of things. You know, you didn't necessarily have to need a whole lot of money. You know, the 80s changed all of that. Because that was the year, by the end of the 80s, that was that year that they had worked in building that separate class of people. You know, still in the 70s, after the 60s, you were still somewhat integrated, although you was free to move around. You just still stayed in your same place. So they never, this separate class of people, this Buffy or whatever it was, that literally made a person think that they're actually different than the other black people. That didn't happen until the end of the 80s. End of the 80s and on into the 90s and stuff like that and all. You know, the upper lower class. You know. That whole thing. But still yet, you know, so it's just and it's just a sad thing. But that's the way things go. A couple of things I want to deal with before I pull the libation. I was talking yesterday, this is the New York Post. And this is on the road to war. This was right before the war started. This was March 11th. The war, they made sure the war started in during the spring equinox. The spring equinox, March the 21st, around that time. That's when they made sure that the war started. But this particular paper, this is the New York Post, but I want to show you this picture. Maybe you can zoom in on it. Brother T, but this is from the New York Post, March 11th. New York Post, March 11th, 2003. And here's a picture. This is a picture. And everything is everything. This is a picture. I'm going to zoom in on this thing. Here's a picture. And from the first glance, you would just think that it's still the Oval Office and he's in charge. But if you study it,
pointing towards me a little bit more.
You study it. This is Condoleezza Rice. She's standing there with something in her hand, like a briefcase, and they got him on the telephone. On the telephone, and usually when they take these Oval Office shots, he's never hardly on the telephone unless it's a private thing. But he's on the telephone, and in so many words, she's standing in charge. And this is a ritual to show you that in actuality, he's like the secretary. Mm-hmm. You see.
But usually, when they in the opposite world, the president is using the highest, the tallest, or standing up.
Exactly. And it's showing you that she's in charge. Now remember, now this is the woman that literally runs the White House. Mm-hmm. You know, and
Now Hakeem Bey had pictures of like George Washington, mm-hmm. with this a Moor like behind him.
Right.
And Hakeem said that, like,
right.
You know, they would always show a white person up front and had a black person next to him and a little bit to the back, and they would tell you, well, this is like they servant or they slave or something.
Right.
Just like in a Robin Hood, Kevin Costner had Morgan Freeman was the Moor.
And even in the movie the movie Rob Roy. Mm-hmm. The head of the town that was taxing all of them, he always had a little black boy in a turban with him.
Mm-hmm.
And in Maul Flanders.
And the black person is the one who's telling the white person what to do.
That's the teacher. That's when they were giving, you know, it's the same thing here. She has the book in her hand. It's got some blue paper. She got on a power gray suit. And she's standing up. And if you notice, she's standing right over the presidential seal in the rug. You see.
And the headline said, decision carries weight, and he just on the phone running his mouth.
Right. You see. And she's standing there, she's got the hand up like she's thinking.
Yeah.
That's the thinker. You see. I never really respected her, but after this, I thought she was a little sexy. And I said, you hold for him, you can hold for me. But the real deal thing here is that now this woman is a Russian scholar. This woman is no slow leak. She has a ship named after her.
Yeah, an oil tanker.
Oil tanker. So that shows you the connection right there. That's where he got her, straight out of the oil business.
Mm-hmm.
Cheney. Oh, okay. So the thing here is, the ritual here is, they say that they will run for cover. And they will put certain people in charge. Now you got to understand what I mean by I say she's really running things, because we know that he's a worker. We know that there's a secret society that runs all of this stuff. And we know that he's no more in charge, you see what I'm saying, than you are in charge. So apparently to have this black woman and Colin Powell, the black man, and Kofi Annan, the black man over the UN, you see what I'm saying, it means that somebody is trying to run for cover. At least in the spiritual sense. Since his job is no more important than the job she's doing, then who's really in charge? When she is the diplomat that's actually running things. You see, like this, to take the same thing with now Tony Blair, when he was convincing Britain to go to war, he had to go down to Parliament every day. You see what I'm saying? Whereas this man, he never had to go before anybody. You see what I'm saying? He might have showed up at the UN one day, but basically he didn't have to go down and plead his case. You see? So it shows you that the thing in Britain, they gave Tony Blair a little more power. You see, although he has a boss, he has a little more important job, whereas this person here is just literally an image, a figure. So therefore, if this woman is the one, her and Colin Powell is the one that's actually running the job, doing the actual work, then who's really in charge? And that's the way they line this stuff up spiritually. You see? The way they line up spiritually. So this is how this thing goes here. And this is a unique picture. And like I said, she's standing right on the seal and right on the rays of the sun. You can pass this around for people that want to see it. Which is interesting here, because now they're even going forth and saying that they lied about all of the weapons of mass destruction, and the reports that they have are all false.
Yeah.
And Bush went so far as to take the same false report and announce it on this during the State of the Union address. And Colin Powell took the same report, and this is the report where he pleaded his case before the UN. But yet, they would come back and saying this thing is completely bogus. They haven't even brought back a damn bullet. I mean, hell, show me a bullet inside our head. See, I got the bullet. This is why we had to go and kill up all these people. You see, they haven't even brought back a bullet. And we knew from the get-go that Saddam Hussein and them wasn't going to never get caught because it was there on it.
Yeah.
You see? Just like the Bin Laden thing. They said, well, hell, we did it again before and these fools.
They failed for it.
Failed for it. Why can't we do it again? But it also shows you the fatted calf where even white people, me personally, I thought that white folks were a little more smarter than this. I figure, you know, we oppress and we go by the TV and stuff like this, but they run a good game on how they supposed to be so-called up on it. You see what I'm saying? But I thought, you know, that they had one or two. But my goodness, it's just amazing. And like one guy said, now it's gotten to the point of a brother down in Atlanta, this black doctor in Atlanta, he said just about every black person he talked to know that this is some bullshit. He said, but the white people, they bank so much on this conservative American-ness and waving them flags, and he's saying to them, it's a form of alienation. You say, well, what about this fucked up war? They still in denial. You know, so every time he says something and try to give them these points about they didn't catch Saddam Hussein this and that and all, he said, you might as well get a banjo or a violin, nah, 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 nah. They just go into this American mode. Like a sickness. It's almost like somebody's leader dying and he didn't turn out to be the Messiah after all. And you just like disenfranchised. So white people are going into total denial. Well, we're just going to have to accept what the president say. You see, what's that?
I think it's called cognitive dissonance.
What is it called?
Cognitive dissonance.
Mm. Cognitive. It was interesting here. It's the same concept here where they go, I don't support the war, but I support the soldiers.
Yeah.
This is a fucking oxymoron. I don't support the man who put out the hit, but I support the hitman. Well, who the hell do you think actually killed somebody with the damn soldiers?
Yeah.
But I don't support the war, but I support the soldiers. What is this? You know what I'm saying? But the same psychological damage is being done. That is being done. And so, it's just showing you that in actuality that you know it's over now. You know it's through when you don't even have, I mean, these people are not, and the funny thing about it was, over in England, they had 1 million people protest on one Saturday. That's a lot of protesting. That's like one of the biggest protest marches in history. You see what I'm saying? 1 million people. And then, a couple of months later and all, and they still sent their soldiers and all this, but it's almost like, they're seeing this thing happen, and it's almost like they're totally blown. Nobody knows what to do. You see? So they're at the point right now, they can even admit that they're wrong in saying, we got so much power, we don't really give a shit what the people think.
Yeah.
You know? What's that?
Yeah, but, I mean, I don't know. Like on C-SPAN and stuff, we have a lot of stuff coming out.
Uh-huh.
And they're not happy with this.
Yeah, naturally, but see, it's always after the fact. Now they're talking junk now.
But where are they going to get all this money from? They're saying $3.9 billion a month they're going to have to spend for this war.
Right. And just to keep the soldiers over there, and they're saying now, it's like I said yesterday, it is official that they're going to have to stay there for 4 years.
Right, right.
You see, they're going to have to stay there for 4 years. That's official. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I was going to say, she was saying, where are they going to get the money? They're just going to put it up because it's not money anyway. I know what's happening is that, okay, like in Michigan, like the governor, there's no money because of his tax cut. One of the things is because of the tax cut, he made $5 billion.
Uh-huh.
There's no money. And the people don't know that yet.
And they said that unemployment is the highest. They announced this Thursday that unemployment now is the highest that it has been in 20 years. So where's this great benefit from this conservative? You know, it's all the same. Democrat, conservative, it's all the same thing. Only people really get into that now, stupid ass black people.
But if it's nonsense, if it's all nonsense that we're looking at a holographic projection, what do we even give a shit?
What this is actually doing is actually good. See, it's monitoring where the energy, it's a good question. It's monitoring where we are right now at this particular time. Honorable Elijah Muhammad said, you will know the end when there's infighting amongst the elite. When this stuff starts to crumble down.
Correct.
You see what I'm saying? So in actuality, it's good. I'll put a picture of George Bush up on my wall. Because he pulled up to the plate. And as a result, he's tearing down the country.
He's
tearing down the country. So on one aspect, yes, and the way I stand, this is confirmation that what I've been saying for the last 11 years, since I've been speaking, that this thing is over. And now we've seen it actually happen, but we're seeing the contradictions that cannot have any cohesion no more. It's just straight out. You see what I'm saying? So you're talking about this apocalypse culture. It's upon us now. So what we're doing is when we're making these reports, we're actually making these particular reports based on how the ship is actually sinking, which is actually good. But like I said yesterday, to start back off, I think you didn't stay for the second half. This whole thing here is they cannot bring the soldiers back home because of some stuff called KAMHSN. KAMHSEN or KAMHSEN. One is an Arabic and one is an Egyptian. I think the Egyptian one is KAMHSEN and the Arabic one is KAMHSEN, which means windstorm and spirit. Now there's a Hebrew word for the same thing. It's spirit and windstorm, or spirit and wind is the same thing. We know this based on the Middle Passage. We know this based on the hurricanes that come through the Atlantic Ocean is all based on some stuff that happened with the energies based on slavery. Okay. You see what I'm saying? So, what's that, brother?
In Hebrew, it's the same word.
Yeah. But in Hebrew, it's the same
word.
Ruach, that's the word, yeah.
Ruach, it means spirit and wind.
Spirit and wind.
Same
you
word.
See, spirit and wind. And you hear some people say, look for me in a wind. Look for me in a whirlwind.
Yeah.
You see. So what you so they when it went through this windstorm, that was the war was fought then. And we don't know whether the secret societies who know all this stuff put those soldiers there in the first place to go through it just to see what would happen. Because when they were showing the soldiers to get people to go to war, they kept showing all these white soldiers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But the majority of the soldiers actually, that they were showing was actually black, because they in Georgia, they had a whole town. You know, they got military towns in the South and in Texas and stuff, but whole towns of black people just going to the service.
Fort Benning,
you know, stuff like that. And all that. Like my town mothers, me and another brother was the only two out of a whole high school class that went to college. All the rest of them went to service. Now it's not really a bad thing at all, because the key with that is, with black people going to the service, is the brothers that go into the service get to travel around the world with the service. And by us being in college, and when we get out of school, we still will never earn enough money to travel the way the people in the service travel.
That's right. That's true.
See what I'm saying? And the only way you get to travel outside of your career is when you get elderly. Then you start taking vacations. But we talk about people 1918 and stuff like that, and been all into the Mediterranean. You see what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Been to Italy, been to Japan, been all over. So in actuality, it balanced out. The majority of the people like in my hometown that went into the service and stuff, they got to go all over the world. You see what I'm saying? We were broke in college, and when we got out to it, you get that little $40,000, $30,000, $20,000, $18,000 a year job, and then by the time you buy all the stuff, you never really get out of the country. So it balances out in that particular thing, but they still have whole towns of black people that's in the military, go through the military. What's that, brother?
I was in the military in the Marine Corps, and half the divisions, the grunts, it was all black.
Yeah. You see, that's your foot soldiers. Mm-hmm. Now, remember now, there was things that said they had this policy, especially after, what's his name, integrated it. The reason why Truman had to integrate is because they knew that in order for them to thin out a certain population every 20-something years, they had to put a certain amount of black people on the front lines to kill up a certain people. But it would kind of look kind of disorganized if you still had this segregated army. So the army was the first to integrate. You see what I'm saying? One of the first institutions to integrate. But so we still know that there's always a process of them sending troops and stuff always to get killed off. But what they're not telling you is they still don't know how many people actually did. Now they got this little white girl, this little white girl that they made a hero. And this little white girl is saying, I don't remember none of this. Right. All the stuff you're telling me, I don't remember any of this. They said that she have amnesia. They tried to lie and said she had amnesia. She said, I didn't have no amnesia. I don't have amnesia. None of this shit happened to me. Okay. So here it is again. We got a person that they just straight up lying. Everything they doing is a bunch of lies. And this white girl is telling the truth. She said, none of this stuff happened. You see what I'm saying? She said, you know. So it's just interesting how this thing goes. But still yet the machine is falling.
There was supposed to be a ritual. She was part of it. But she was from Palestine, West Virginia.
Mm.
That shuttle went down in Palestine. Then they found Saddam over in Palestine.
Well, not only that.
Something like that.
Not only that. The shuttle had a Jew on it, and it was celebrating.
Yeah.
And it had all the other people, all the other people and stuff on there also too. It's about like that Independence Day where the Jew and the black man get to go up there and kill E.T. You know what I'm saying, in the movie. So yes, it's all a ritual that's going down. But like I said yesterday, we got it about a week after the war ended. The sister from California called and said, those soldiers are very sick. A lot of them are sick. And so they got to keep them over there. And like I said yesterday, now let's look at the magnitude of what we're talking about here. How in the hell are you going to say you're only losing two soldiers a day? But yet you got to keep 150,000 soldiers over there, as well as they bringing more soldiers back. And probably some of the ones that they brought back, they got to go back. Which was funny. I thought this was beautiful. Had Woodcracker had was in the Army and retired. You know, young boy, but he retired. He was in the Army all the 90s, retired. And he figured he going to go back in the Army after 9/11. And he was one of the first crackers to get killed over there. You know what I'm saying? But the key here is that stuff, that Tamsin. And like Farrakhan says, you know, you will go to war, but when you get, but and you might be successful, but when you come home, America's going to fall. Well, they brought back two or three shiploads of people, of soldiers that hit these shores recently, and yet they were all caught up in the same windstorm. the same windstorm, which leads me to this, which is now prophecy. I read this back in Easter, but read this again. So this is, I'm finding out something about mythology. And then we're going to go through a little libation. I'm finding out something about mythology. This is Goetic Evocation by Steve Sabado. This is the book that every time you try to order, if you go in a bookstore and you get it off the shelf, they will sell it to you. But anytime you try to get the bookstore to order it for you, they never say they're out of it. You know, you have to go in and find what bookstore and you just get it off the shelf and they can't deny you. But when you go to Barnes and Noble and Borders, they automatically come back and say, we're out of it. Now you can order it probably from online, from a Shaitan, shaitan.com publications. But page 81, I want to read this particular point again because this ended up being prophecy. I read it when I was here the last time, and when I was reading it, I thought it was something that happened 5,000 years ago. 5,000 or 6,000 years ago. After the war, and after after seeing what was actually going down, I realized that this was something that they wrote to go down in 2003. That's the beautiful thing about mythology. It's so advanced until one line it can be the past and the other line can be something in the future. And world religions are based off of this mythology. You see what I'm saying? And that's what makes this stuff so advanced. So I'm going to read this again now. There's a pre-Solomon. First of all, there is no historical Solomon. For all you Bible-toting people, there's no historical Abraham. Abraham and Brahma. You go to India, Brahma. You scramble the words, Brahma and Abraham, they're one and the same. You see what I'm saying? They're one and the same. I say this not to level that tradition that you are in, but to try to show you, if you look at these people as mythological figures, you give them more power. Because Solomon here is Osiris. You see what I'm saying? There's the book. It's always the Jewish books, they always take out of print because they don't want you to do so. There's three volumes of a book called The Legends of Israel. The Legends of Israel by Angelo S. Rappaport. Angelo S. Rappaport. It come out of England, but if you go to the Strand Bookstore in New York, and if you go to the Strand Bookstore in New York, and somehow they're able to get hold to them. There's a bookstore in Manhattan called the Strand. There's one downtown Manhattan, and there's one near the World Trade Center, near the Financial District, and all. Strand Bookstore, and there's three volumes of the Legend of Israel. And the reason why they don't want to show you those particular books is just like that book, Robert Graves' book, Hebrew Myths. Somehow they keep these books. They will pay the publishers not to even print these books. Because if you study it, you can see that Solomon and Sheba is Osiris and Isis. You see, and the priest of Solomon is the priest of Osiris. You see, and Abraham is Amun-Ra. You see, is Amun-Ra. So you get this concept of someone taking the ancient mythology and historicalizing it. And historicalizing it. Well, so Solomon here is a priesthood, is what you're dealing with here. So apparently these priesthood are trying to shut down or seal some type of ancient pre-dynastic energy. Now, as Kenneth Grant said, that there was rituals that the pre-dynastic Egyptians had that could destroy the earth. But when the Ammonites came in and the dynastic Egyptians, they destroyed a lot of this stuff. Well, this particular passage encapsulates that exactly what Kenneth Grant had talked about in Gerald Massey. So this particular priesthood says these 72 mighty kings and princes. Well, there's 72 children of Ptah. And Ptah is the Kamite architect of humans. And Ptah is a form of Osiris. In some of the books, it's called Ptah Osiris in some of the books. You see, a Ptah Osiris, you get the word Pythagoras. Pythagorean theory, Ptah Osiris, you get the word Pythagoras. You see what I'm saying? So there's 72 children of Ptah. That's noted in your book, Celestial Ship of the North. First book, the first section of the book, the first book, I think the African origins of the Hebrew race in that particular Celestial Ship of the North, the 72 sons and daughters of Ptah. So there's 72 mighty kings and princes in which Solomon commanded into a vessel of brass together with their legions. Now, anytime you hear the word legion, legions is mean 10,000. Legion means 10,000. They even gave a quote on how many of these particular entities we're talking about here. Something like 2 billion. So a lot of people up in the damn, up in our ship. 2 billion spirit forces. You get a sense of it in the movie The Mummy, Part 2, when they show those Anubis warriors, you know, killing up everything and all, and the Scorpion King. So, the 72 princes whom King Solomon commanded into a vessel of brass together with their legions, in whom Belial, Beliath, Asmodee, and Gath were chief. Well, that was the past right there of this particular thing. This is, I'm noticing when you study mythology, and the woman O'Flaherty said it, you'll have one or two lines will be 10,000 years, and then the next couple of lines, the next couple of sentences will jump 10,000 years into the future. So we're going to go, so this is, right now we're in the past. 72 mighty kings with Prince Solomon commanded into a vessel of brass with their legions whom Belial, Beliath, Asmodee, and Gath were chief. And it is to be noted that Solomon did this because of their pride, for he never declared any other reason why he thus bound them. And when he had thus bound them up and sealed the vessel by the divine power, and we're going to go into the metaphysical thing on what this means also too, by the divine power into a deep lake or a hole in Babylon. And we know Babylon is ancient Babylon, later on is ancient Persia, and in 1925 they named it ancient Iraq, a modern Iraq. So he thus bound these demons up in a vessel of brass and chased them into a lake, into a deep hole in Babylon. So that is the past. Okay. Now the future comes. So now we're getting ready to go to 2003. And they of Babylon, wondering what to see such a thing, they did then go into the lake and break open the vessels. Well, this is going on, you know, they did go to Iraq, they had a war, they got bombs blowing up everything, expecting to find great treasures therein. We know they were over there for the museum, you know what I'm saying, we know they were over there with all that, so they expected to find a great treasure therein. But when they broke open the vessels, out flew chief spirits immediately, Khamsin. That's the stuff. Khamsin, out flew chief spirits immediately, and their legions following them. And they were all restored to their former places except Belial, who entered into a certain image and gave answers unto those who did offer sacrifices unto him and did worship the image of their God, etc. So what we're talking about here is somebody going into some place and breaking open something and unleashing something. You see what I'm saying? Go get the movie Wishmaster 1, Wishmaster 2, all of this stuff, these movies. Wishmaster 1, Wishmaster 2, even the movie Tomb Raider, Lara Croft's Tomb Raider. There was a hell of a movie called, it's a movie called The Guardian with Mario Van Peebles. Mario Van Peebles, The Guardian, and Ice-T. And they were over in Iraq. They just made it in 91, but they dug up this grave. When they dug up this particular grave in Iraq, on the side, it was this very ancient artifacts, this tomb. Here goes again, he was digging up some tomb. And on the side of the tomb, it said, and the dead shall eat the living. Or the dead shall, yeah, no, the dead shall outnumber the living. On the actual tomb. Beside the tomb was this pink stuff in jars. This pink looking stuff looked like pink sawdust or something. And you know, pink washing powder or whatever, this powder. And anyway, it was in these big jars. The scene shifts there in the early 2000s. And this stuff has hit the streets in America. This drug, which is this pink substance, and when the people take it, they go violently crazy and start killing up everybody. And the drug is called chaos. Now, as we know, chaos is what melanin is. And the chief pusher of the drug chaos is Ice-T in the movie. But there's this entity that these other people are trying to stop that's going to destroy the earth that was let out in Iraq, which is interesting here because it said the dead will destroy the living. Now, the last time I was here, I mentioned this. This is the book, The Myths from Mesopotamia, Creation, the Flood, Gilgamesh, and Others, by Stephanie Daly or Stephanie Daly, D-A-L-L-E-Y. This particular book here, Myths from Mesopotamia. And in this particular book, there's the descent of Ishtar. Ishtar has to descend into the underworld. To get her husband, in this particular case, Tammuz or Dumuzi. It's Ishtar in one mythology, it's Inanna in another mythology. They change it up a little bit in the Greek mythology, and that becomes the Stephanie. Now, for Stephanie is what you saw. Anybody saw the movie The Matrix? Reloaded? And the woman in the pink dress that wanted to kiss Neo? She was for Stephanie, but she was being held captive by a Hades figure, which in the mythology, she descended in the underworld. She's being held captive by a Hades figure. And she wants to kiss Neo because she remembered that she used to be in love. There's a woman who wrote a whole book on this, of the Persephone mythology. And in this particular book, she makes her analogy based on modern day male and female, what you talk about a Persephone type character, this beautiful woman that's snatched into the underworld and being held captive by Hades. She marries Hades, but she's being held captive by him. And although he gives all these riches and stuff, she's being held captive by him. Anybody saw the movie The Cell? The movie The Cell, with Jennifer Lopez, and she has to go into this man's mind, and when she gets down there, that's Hades, and the next thing you know, she gets trapped down there, and when they come in there, she's sitting up on the throne. Well, the Hades males, basically, the name of the book is Earth's Daughter, Hell's Bride. Now, this woman makes her thesis in saying that women can have a Hades male in their life. And the Hades male is basically the ultimate chauvinistic male figure that dominates your life. But the Hades male is also, in psychology, he's dominating your life because he has psychological problems and he's really weak. And to not show this force of masculinity means that in actuality he'll have to unmask his idiosyncrasies and all his pathologies. You see. So because he's deranged in one aspect, you see what I'm saying, he puts it all on you and say that you the one ain't shit. You know, you're never doing the right thing. You know what I'm saying? You know, you stupid. You especially got a motherfucker calling you stupid. You married to him and they calling you stupid all the damn time. That is an indication of the incompleteness and the psychological damage of this particular Hades male. This Hades male. She can shift, and you get rare cases of Hades females, more control freaks, controlling mechanisms, where they use some form of whatever their lofty stability, be financial or whatever stuff, to control the other partner. So it can go either way, but mainly in a patriarchal society, the society that we live in, the Persephone figure is victim to the Hades male. You know, to the Hades male. Your life is fine as long as it's not it's not challenging to his ego or to his idiosyncrasies. And the ego is only to mask his shortcomings. You see what I'm saying? So if he just lets up and just be himself and all that, means that all that shit got to fly out. You see what I'm saying? You know, got to fly out. You know what I'm saying? And I got some brother down in Atlanta. He figured he got this shit. He got this thing. He got this thing worked out. He said, shit, I cry in front of him all the time. You know? I said, well, I ain't at that level yet. He said, shit, I give him the paddle and let him beat my ass. And I just cry. So obviously this brother broke through. You see what I'm saying? And as a result, all the women and all the men always calling him for the advice when they fucked up with their mates and stuff like that and all. Because he's the one, he said, that's what I do. I just listen. And, you know, give them all this advice and stuff like that, you know. You know, so it's that type of aspect. Or when you come to the planet with no more tears. They talk about it in the book of Zelator. Whereas you can get to a certain level of spirituality, but it's based on how much tears you got left in you. You got to shed all of that. You know what I'm saying? You have to shed all of that type of stuff, you know. And so to get rid of the particular ego aspect, you see, you have to shed all of that type of stuff. You know, on one particular aspect and all that. I said, I got a good one here. I'm like, yo, baby, you can come to the house and you can think of any man you want to think of, long as you giving me some. You can be the baddest motherfucker in your dreams. I am securing my masculinity. Hey, you ain't turned nobody, just think of another nigga. It don't matter, shit. You know, think of some big black nigga or whatever, yo, whatever floats your boat and shit. If it's a midget, think of that motherfucker. The whole concept here is the different ways to shed the actual ego. To shed the actual ego. One of the main ones that's facing most of the sisters, because the last 30 years with the women's live is everything they have attributed the ego to males. And what they've turned out to find out here is the biggest egos are females, because you got double thing, you got vanity you have to deal with, then all other kind of idiosyncrasies and inconsistencies of being the double oppressed person, you have a major ego for protection. But women have huge egos, especially when it comes to other women. You see what I'm saying? And that will be the tool right there. That will be the tool right there, is to accept the other woman, to neutralize your ego. And when I'm saying accepting the other woman, I'm just talking about even in friendship. Sometimes give in, because, you know, give in the aspect of don't trip because the bitch done made you mad. You see what I'm saying? The whole concept here is she is only the adversary in the concept of the hero. They always have to have an adversary. And how you deal with the adversary is how you go to another level. You see what I'm saying? So she is only the adversary. Oh, the spirit done told me I gotta say some funny shit that went down with me in 2001. I didn't put it on the tape, but I gotta put this on the tape. It's some funny stuff. It's time though. So you accept the adversary, so you go to the other level. So sometimes, especially with the sisters, you hear sisters all the time, all my friends are males. We quit to say that, you see, and that's because you're not dealing with the other sister. And I know that everybody got the problem, but that is the adversary. That is the person that is sent for you to become better. It's not the male that is sent for you. Yes, you know, but see, you don't really see, when you say all my friends are males and stuff, you know, he's an opposite. And sometimes you don't become better by dealing with the opposite. It's easy to deal with the opposite because it's outright. There's no competition with the opposite, as it is someone that is on the same level as you are in sharing that type of realm of womanhood. So a lot of times the key here now is for the sister to get past, to neutralize her ego by how she deals with the other sister. And that's the hardest thing to do, because you got competition. You see what I'm saying? In the concept of this is a patriarchal culture, and everything is competition, whether we like it or not, around the male. When it all boils down to some stuff, it's competition around the male. Okay. Now, this is what happened based on this in the mythology. In the mythology, the hero sets out, and he has to get to a certain journey. Okay? He has to get to a certain journey. Within the journey, there's always a dragon. And he has to get past that dragon to reach the benefits. All right. In this particular case, it has something to do with a female. Now, we had already figured out, because I got these spiritual mate, these spiritual sisters around me. That's in the movie, Minority Report, that the highest form of channels on the psychic level would be these sisters. So, okay, so I got these spiritual sisters, one in California and one in Atlanta. Are the ones that have been doing the channeling for me since the millennium. So, whenever I run into some things in spiritual, I always consult the oracle. You see. Now, I have the channel too, and it is in my head also what I'm thinking, but a lot of times I'm consulting the oracle to confirm what I'm thinking. Or sometimes I'm consulting the oracle because there's something that I missed that she needs to give me. So what I would call up the sister Kimberly, and we had come to the conclusion that this sister who was going to come to visit was a former Sheena Master. Now Sheena Master is a sister or entity or goddess in the book The Ten Mahavadayas. It's a book called Ten Mahavadayas. I talked about that book. It's a blue book by David, what's the guy name on? David Kinsley, Ten Mahavadayas. Or you get his book Hindu Goddess, which is I think the Hindu Goddess is probably a better book. Because they talk about the Ten Mahavadayas in there, but the Hindu Goddess by David R. Kinsley. It's a hell of a book. So there's an entity in, one of the entities, which is a form of Kali, is called the Ten Mahavadaya. And there's some funny shit that went down. But hell. When the spirit comes and stuff, I have to tell this particular story. The names have been changed to protect the innocent anyway, so. Okay. So, this sister was coming through to visit. We knew she was coming to bring a whole lot of energy. And so the sister Kimberly said, hey, this is Sheena Master. Now, Sheena Master is an energy that's so primal and so wild till she cuts off her own head. You know, I'm like, wow, you know, cuts off her own head. But little did I know that it was a dragon, it was the dragon or the Sheena Master type thing, you know, was somebody that I'm going to have to get past because my training as a male is based on a certain way that males are trained visually, and certain archetypes of images that we look for in the women. You see what I'm saying? That we deal with. So the test is going to be on. So I'm waiting for Sheena Master to come. She's coming for 2 or 3 days. She takes this bus down to Atlanta. She get off the doggone bus, and I recognize immediately that this motherfucker here is damn near borderline retarded. She got on a Roy Rogers fucking shirt. This motherfucker, I'm like, oh, fuck, hell. One of the fucking eyes is damn near crossed. Shit! Fuck that I got into. That damn down some Roy Rogers shirt, these fucked up jeans, some high top canvas sneakers with a motherfucking with some heels on them, some white marshmallow heels shit to look like Boosie collars. What the fuck going on? Hell crazy. Now clearly I look at this woman and say, this motherfucker here is flicked like a motherfucker here. Bust up. Flicked it. It's a damn house I call fucking Kimberly up. Kimberly say, uh-huh. Dragon on the energy. You gotta go through with it. You wanna get to the next stage? See the dragon on the energy into the damn game. You wanna get to the next stage and stuff, you gotta go through with it. And she got a body. Killer body. All hell get up. I mean, fine as shit now with the body. But, you know, shit, I gotta shave this motherfucker the next morning. I said, oh, Lord Jesus, Lord, help me, Lord Jesus, Lord. I don't know Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus, Lord, help me, Lord Jesus. You know, nigga, quick to call on Jesus. He go to damn devil. Call it on Jesus. You know you fucked up when you get the devil to call on Jesus. Okay, bothering you because you know what this is about. See, it's, you know what it's about. It's that part about that male image. You know what I'm saying? That image that you're trying to do, and you got to get past that. Because obviously, whatever it is, they say in the thing, they say, why put a precious jewel in a beautiful bottle? The thieves will steal it. You put it in a fucked up. It's in the movie, The Last Crusade, Indiana Jones and The Last Crusade. They say, choose the glass or the goblet or whatever that a carpenter, his drinking fast. And one guy chose this brass glass and all the gold, and he drank out of it and died. And one guy chose the old beat up thing. He said, you chose wisely, and he drank out of it, and you know. They said this would be what a carpenter would be. So in the concept, whatever this came in, it was right after 9/11. It was right after 9/11. And this thing came, man, and so I had to shave her ass. I had to shave her chest. Seriously, I swear to God. Oh, Lord Jesus. Had to shave her chest. I had to cut her hair. And shit, I mean, she was fucked up. And I'm talking to her and all, and I realize this motherfucker here is, because she put her mama on the phone, and the mama's talking to me like, I said, damn, your mama talked to you like you like 4 years old. But I didn't realize mama was like, hey, nigga, who the fuck is you? Well, she's conscious though. No, the sister was conscious.
Okay.
So this is what threw me the fuck off. You know, and she educated, you know what I'm saying? But she one of them people that's always been crazy. You know what I'm saying? I said, where the fuck your lipstick? I don't lipstick. I want to buy my lipstick from the dollar store. You know this motherfucker here crazy. I want to buy my lipstick from the dollar store. I said, damn, your hair, you fix your hair. Well, I don't fix my hair, you know. Like, oh, so you never know how to fix your hair. My mom fixed my hair and shit. What this crazy motherfucker? I communicate, I'm ringing up Kendall the phone. And so Kendall's like, okay, this is what the deal is. I said, you need to call Uncle Combo, the spirit entity of the sexual conquest. You need to call Uncle Combo, I need to draw him in and see. Kakumbo said, okay, look, I tell you what. I know this is going to be difficult, but trust me on this one. At 12 o'clock each night, I will come through. I stayed in the house down there 3 days. I said, hell no. I took it to the movies one day. It was way dark one night. Dark night, dark movie. And so all the friends was like, damn, man, we was interested in meeting the sister. You know, why you never call us to come over and shit? You know, what happened? You just disappeared. I said, oh, yeah, man, you know, man. You know, lockdown, man. This shit here was a nightmare. You know? And every night at 12 o'clock, he would come through, and I was able to do what I had to do. But see, the thing about it was a law, it was an advanced spirit. Because on the third night, we heard some entities inside her stomach hollering out like, oh! I said, oh, shit! And it was some gateway of something she was holding with a whole lot of energy that had to be unlocked for the people. It was the energy that needed to be unlocked to come into this dimension. But the whole thing is they were gonna put it in the dragon. You see what I'm saying? And me being the person that deals with all this bizarre shit, they go, we got your ass now. Send this motherfucker right in the lounge. You know, nice girl, beautiful body, unbelievable. It's like, you know how you see them those things that had a body, the beautiful body, and they take a head of damn Godzilla and cut it off, put it under the body, like that. She got a fucking trick eye. I don't know whether she's looking at the TV or looking at me. I'm like, you need to make the fuck up your mind up. This shit scared the fuck out of me. You spying on me or some shit like this? I don't know whether the way you're looking at all. But now I say this in a joking thing, but it was highly spiritual because Sister Kendall was saying, nigga, you and your beautiful maidens, you gotta get through this one right here. And there was a certain, and so there's so many words what it is of this here. They got these entities out here and they hold certain keys to certain things. And this was some stuff that needed to be opened right up after 9/11, and she had it. You see what I'm saying? And obviously, whatever the deal is and all, but I should have known something was wrong when she sent me a picture in 2001 from 1982. You know, where I still look sane. So the last day, I had to go out to my brother to pick up some stuff. You know, I couldn't avoid it because it was something I needed. Some papers or something I needed. I can't remember what it was, to pick up something. I couldn't avoid it. He said, I'm sending a car to pick you up. I'm like, damn. I'm like, you got some dresses or some shit like that? She had a suitcase full of beautiful dresses. Y'all got some dresses, but it's cold out there. I don't have no dresses. Like, look. You just kind of fix, spruce yourself up a little bit, hands, you know. Shit, man, she start kicking and going around the house like a little kid kicking over shit. Picking up a man, dressing and stuff like that and all, you know. I'm looking at this thing, man, and all, you know. I said, well, just wear what you want. And she put on them damn white high heels, sneakers with the bootsy boots and stuff like that and all this kind of thing, you know. And she had some little Velcro pocketbook little thing that she got from some Barbie set or some shit like that. You know, it was real fucked up, man. But the key here was, I say that in telling you this experience is, we gotta go through something to get the benefit. In this particular case, it was a part of my initiation. Everybody have a certain form of you gotta meet the dragon. You know what I'm saying? You gotta meet the doggone dragon. You know. So I met the dragon. And it was all cool. About a month later, she like, hey, I'm getting ready to come down there for Thanksgiving. I say, you can stay up in this motherfucker not every day. Hell no, I done got the juice. Oh hell no. But the whole concept here is, and the concept of what we're going through now here is, that's just like somebody said, you know, the brother was discussing, he wanted to get into the consciousness, but he said if he could get his hand on a whole bunch of cash, it would make the consciousness or make everything a lot easier. And I say it ain't gonna come that way. It's not gonna come on the terms on what you want. You see what I'm saying? Because that's your ego. You see what I'm saying? You're gonna have to learn how to break down your particular ego, as well as I see it when the sisters, a lot of times the people that you're gonna have to deal with so that you can neutralize your ego is not gonna be another male. You can do that. You've been used to going into combat with males, so you pretty much accept certain things about males that you can deal with or you're not gonna deal with. But it's the other sister, that's the one. Them know what, that's the one you hate, is the other sister. That's the one that you quit to cut off in a goddamn minute. That bitch think that, bitch think she is, she think she is shit. You know what I'm saying? Now, it doesn't necessarily mean that you are not in, that you are in error for some of her pathology. Some of the stuff you are dealing with is right. But the key here is you gotta learn how to release all that to try to understand it doesn't matter what she does. I gotta understand that we are all trapped in this hell and we gotta go beyond that. You see what I'm saying? So it doesn't matter the idiosyncrasies and stuff. And this is, I'm saying this because this is real big amongst sisters. You see, this is real big amongst sisters when it comes to the competition with other females. This shit is major. You see what I'm saying? I'm not talking about some young girl shit. We got some, I know two sisters, man, been friends for 27 years. You know what I'm saying? They late 40s, early 50s, 27 years, and last summer, one of them stopped speaking to each other. Yeah. But goddamn, you was friends for 27 years. Don't you think you can ride this shit out? You know what I'm saying? But I realize, and see, the energy is getting more and more. And see, now, not only that, what's happening here is saying, because we're coming closer and closer into this realm where we get ready to get out of this thing, the forces are going to come in the things that annoy you. So that's what they say, those forces say, well, we need to get them off the path. So they're going to come, they're going to either come with the family members, or they're going to come, which is Richard, you know, you can write them motherfuckers off. You're going to come with the family members, or they're going to come with your girlfriend. Now, the one that you're supposed to try to understand, especially the girlfriend, especially if you're a confidant in consciousness. Now, the one that's non-conscious and stuff like that, you know, you just got to just say, look, you just got to let that go. It's like one brother called me and said, yo, man, other week, what you doing for the fourth? I said, nothing. He said, yo, man, let's drive, won't you, let's ride to Louisiana to the Essence Festival and stuff together and stuff like that. And I said, well, I might have a lecture on that day. And my man was over there, I said, well, damn, why you got out of it? I was like, it's clear, I don't want to go no fucking 12 hours or how long it's going to take to Atlanta. 8, 9, 10, 12 hours with somebody ain't got nothing on their mind. If I'm going to be in a car stuck with a person, I need a person to have a conversation about this stuff that we into.
That's right.
Ain't with so much the small talk going to run out by the time I get to Tennessee. Yeah. See what I'm saying? Ain't with so much small talk I can talk about. Ain't with so much shit I can talk about on the news or some slinger or whatever the deal he is, or Kobe Bryant or whatever. That's going to run out by Chattanooga. You know what I'm saying? Now I got to go up and fucking Louisiana and shit. I ain't gonna be stuck in no car with no nigga. Okay, if we got a plane trip, fine. That's only an hour and a half. Wait, damn near any place in the country except LA, what, 2 hours, now 3 hours? But I'm like, I'm not gonna get in no car and go on a road trip with somebody, because they always say, if you really want to learn a person that you with, travel with them.
Yeah.
That's when you in a make or break of a relationship in any kind. You want to see if a motherfucker fucked up? Get on the road with him. And you either ain't gonna fuck with him when you come back, or you gonna still be cool. Cause when you travel with a person, I say when you really tap into a person, you get to know them. They always, if you really want to know somebody, travel with them. That's why it's good if you meet somebody and you meet a sister, you meet anybody, is to go on a trip with them. You see, even with the plane thing, even you go to the hotel, by the time you go on a vacation, you don't know what time it is.